Hello, and welcome to Doctor Who 50 Years Ago, the show that looks back to the episode that aired in 1970, and looks at the differences between then and now. This week, episode 6 of The Ambassadors, Twang, of Death, where we load our pistol and fire the plot at you. I am Ben.
I'm Luke.
And I'm Nick.
And here we are, and here we go into the news from 1970. Firstly, on Monday the 20th of April, proposals are being mooted about creating a new education act to replace the one from 1944, which formed a part of the post-war consensus. The National Association of Schoolmasters recommends a big single-purpose authority to govern education instead of local government doing it, and also to remove statutory requirements on religious education and worship in state schools, something that the Church of England is in favour of retaining. It's an exercise in plurality, in recognising that the state schools needn't practice Christianity quite so hard as it had been doing up until that point, but also perhaps it's a tiny recognition of the fact that the diaspora who go to state schools in this time and age aren't just white lower class kids from English families, but instead an eclectic mix of races and ethnicities that befits Britain in the 1970s, a generation or so after 1944.
In terms of nowadays, there's some other developments going on. Richmond Council have put humanism in their religious education curriculum. So that's showing an extension of beliefs nowadays among all sorts of people, not really related to specific bands of culture.
Yes, it's definitely widening the boundaries. And from humble beginnings in the 70s up until now.
Who's in charge of Richmond Council? Like, which party is it?
Lib Dems.
Okay, that makes sense.
On Tuesday, the 21st of April, there's a report about how office work in central London is enticing more girls to the city as opposed to any engineering, technician, scientific research and telecommunications jobs in the suburbs. This enticement has been going on since the 1950s, what with London becoming a swinging place with awful accommodation for said girls to survive in order to get a job. See the difference between 50 years ago and now, where London is almost semi-impossible to live in on a budget.
In a sense, there's been no change, because every other month, whatever, you'll see some article, or even every other week, talking about how there's a shortage of people in STEM subjects. And then, especially, oh, there's not enough women doing it, blah, 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 that sort of thing. And it's like, oh, we're still in the same situation that we were about 50 years ago, where they're still writing articles, much the same thing. Although they are written in a rather different tone 50 years ago. The article's headline is Council aim to lure girl workers. I feel like they wouldn't be quite so belittling in describing women trying to get into work now as girl workers.
Yeah, particularly the use of the word lure.
There was a youth employment service that placed girls and boys. So that's interesting. I don't believe such a thing exists now, does it? Up until very, very recently, state intervention was frowned upon in this country and in the West in general in recent years compared to 50 years ago. But that perhaps will change very shortly.
Perhaps. Yeah. Friday the 24th of April, police introduced a new method for identifying suspects in crimes. This was the PhotoFit system, which used a giant collection of eyes, mouths, noses and hair to help the public identify suspects. And all they had to do was put them all together and try not to invoke Hamish Wilson if they did it all wrong.
So, here are the stats on exactly how PhotoFit worked. There were 81 pairs of eyes, 70 noses, 86 mouths, but 169 foreheads. So presumably the foreheads were what they were really banking on to solve crimes in 1970. So originally there were highly skilled artists who would have to be employed by the police in order to draw these sketches. But the force have wanted to change this for a while because, of course, this is a terrible time-consuming system and not very accurate. There were issues with this kind of thing. There is a general thing where you're always going for something simpler, less time-consuming, and with less room for human error, as HAL 9000 would want. So eventually you ended up with EFITs, but EFITs aren't very good. 90% never reach the public at large, and ones that do are terrifying or have mixed results. So, but the thing is, when you see a lot of police appeals nowadays, it says, does anyone have dash cam footage of this collision? Does anyone have doorbell or personal CCTV footage of this burglary?
So we've gone from a time-consuming human system as employed by the police to the use of technology, to the use of technology by others.
And well, the police themselves now, well, the Metropolitan Police in particular, were trialling, in January 2020, they were trying out facial recognition software on...
Oh, yes.
Yeah, with cameras on people, just as regular shoppers there. So we've gone to outsourcing, and now we don't even involve human beings in this at all. We're just having artificial intelligence, effectively.
And finally, the news in brief. Unemployment in Britain is at its highest level since a fuel crisis in 1947. The figures stood at 616,000 people, or 2.7% of the workforce. Compare that to February 2020, where figures were at 3.9% of people aged 16 and over, or 1.34 million people. Nevertheless, these unemployment figures in 1970 are said to contribute to the Labour government's defeat in the upcoming general election.
Those figures, well, up to just now, anyway, were considered pretty low and effectively full employment. It just shows how 50 years... our idea of full employment has changed a bit. Also, the figures have changed to be more generous than they were 50 years ago.
Yes.
So, you know, even when trying to massage the figures, they're still percentage-wise were higher at the peak of the boom that we were having in the end of the last decade.
And that's about as much facts and figures as you can stomach, so we'll stop that right there. That was the news, and now we shall get on to the Ambassadors of Death, Episode 6. Aired Saturday the 25th of April. 99% of what's going on is revealed. Astronauts kidnapped by aliens. Aliens kidnapped by conspirators, criminals and generals alike. The Doctor, Brig and Cornish, and Liz as well, trying to help, but still being outplayed by the conspirators. It's a very loaded episode, and definitely a step up from last week. The space spy thriller lives on.
So it's at this episode that I kind of lost my patience with it. And it's when Regan breaks into the army base for, what, the second or third time or whatever it is. I just started laughing and I was imagining Doctor saying something and Regan just hitting him around the head with a script, shouting, "Nope, I can do that." And that's the problem with the all-powerful conspiracy story. Because you kind of just have to make up that they can do things, otherwise there's no tension. And, ugh, I hate these kind of stories. But everything that wasn't Regan, I kind of digged.
It should have been somebody else. It shouldn't... Him doing it once is okay. Him doing it twice, as you say, is just... does break your suspension of disbelief. I guess you can't imagine Carrington... No, Carrington could have done it. It's a bit more his style, isn't it? Yeah, it is rather surprising the lack of security. But what presumably would be one of the most sensitive places in Britain that had developed a space program, this would probably be.
Yeah, we've all played GTA, where you try and break into the army base and a tank shoots your head off. You know, where's the tank?
Well-stocked conspirators, such is the nature of this episode. And indeed, it drives the plots, so we better talk about that plot in greater detail. The Doctor's recovery capsule collides with the unidentified fleshy object, and the Doctor is taken into what is a spacecraft of some aliens. Inside, he discovers all the missing astronauts who believe they are on Earth in extended quarantine. They have been mind-controlled by the aliens holding them, who are slightly unhappy because their ambassadors to Earth were kidnapped by the conspirators of death. And finally, just a little offside from me, go to the light is a really awkward way of saying enter the abstract fleshy spaceship, but that's just my preference.
The Doctor mentions, I think when he's still on the craft, our three astronauts. Do you have our three astronauts? And I thought, oh, he's gone a bit native, hasn't he?
Well, I suppose he's acting as an ambassador for the human race.
Yeah, it's just interesting considering the last serial, he was very much not human. That was very much emphasised whilst here. So.
What year did A Space Odyssey come out?
So 2001 A Space Odyssey was 1968, I think.
Yes, exactly. So what I kind of liked about this was it was kind of introducing that sort of religious imagery. And what year did Star Trek The Slow Motion Picture come out?
Oh, 1979, well in the future.
Okay, but that's kind of ripping off this, I suppose. Ripping off.
Yeah, you're right. This bit definitely feels 2001 like based, doesn't it? Like, this idea of this fleshy spaceship and the alien seems a lot more realistic than aliens do in Doctor Who. It feels like this could be a realistic alien present.
Until you see it.
No, I like that. I think it looks plausible. I mean, based on their budget, it looks weird. That's what I mean. That's why it's good. It doesn't look like a normal Doctor Who alien, does it?
It's a hand-me-down ice warrior, but I get your point.
Probably makes it seem strange is the fact there's that bit where the Doctor walks through a CSO set. And it works here because it's only like 10, 20 seconds, as opposed to an entire serial like Underworld. Here it's just showing how otherworldly this particular ship is. And then they smartly take us to a set that they've already used to trick the astronauts, which is a clever little writing trick to save budget. Well, I guess it's certainly following the view that they wanted to have better special effects than the 60s.
Ben, what did you want to say about Barry?
The pioneer director and producer, he wanted to use colour separation overlay just to expand television's horizons, as you say, to provide more sets relatively cheaply and to take full advantage of the limited studio spaces that the BBC had.
Compare Underworld, does it need saying?
Yeah, but you have to think that ultimately in the timeline of colour separation overlay, you have to have the success of the Ambassadors of Death to get towards the failure of Underworld.
Yeah. Mm.
Good, right. And now it's time for a CSO backdrop change. General Carrington wants to destroy the alien spaceship and goes to brief the United Nations to do so, but the Brigadier and Cornish are not convinced and suspicious about Carrington. The Brig does not want to attack blindly, which is in character, so nicely done, Hulk. The Doctor agrees to help return the ambassadors to hopefully avoid a war between them and Earth, and leaves the Earth astronauts as hostages. Meanwhile, the Brig is narrowing down who the conspirators are, criminals with up-to-date military explosives, and he's also being a detective in trying to track down the criminals, but he's still having difficulty. And then the Doctor returns to talk to Cornish and the Brig and to get him back to Earth.
Apparently the Security Council's in Geneva? Does it mention the UN or does it just say, oh, I have to go to the Security Council?
It just says the Security Council, but surely the Brigadier's with the UN, so...
Yes, it's a bit... Either way, the Security Council of the United Nations meets in New York, not in Geneva. Geneva's like the number two location for the UN. But perhaps... There's been an amalgamation of different writers, including some older writers such as Malcolm Hulk and whatever limited impact David Whittaker had. Perhaps they were thinking more of the League of Nations, which was based in Geneva, but it obviously failed its duty as World War II happened under its watch.
Mm.
I agree with you, Ben, about the whole thing with the Brigadier, because so we just saw the last episode, the Brigadier killed the Silurians. But he's not bloodthirsty and he's not overly aggressive. He only uses force when he thinks it's necessary. And he doesn't revel in violence, does he?
No.
And that's what sets him apart from Carrington, so he was showing that you can actually have a military type who uses force appropriately or proportionally, and then we have another military type who is just that stereotype of just bloodthirsty.
Liz learns that the ambassadors are aliens, only now, after everybody else, of course, and the conspirators boast about Lennox's death to her and threaten Liz to be on their side. And then the conspirators are ordered by their superior to rout the Doctor, who's come back to Earth. To do this, they gas and kidnap him as he's being decontaminated from his landing. They're very well equipped, these conspirators. And also the whole return to Earth bit is very casually underplayed, in my opinion. But I do wonder what Nick thinks about it. And the whole conversation between the Brig and Cornish about, well, you're lucky that decontamination's come on quite rapidly. It used to take 2 days.
Yeah, no, I feel like that's probably Hulk and Terwince acknowledging, yeah, no, an hour is not realistic. Somehow the Doctor lands on the landing pad. To get an orbit and trajectory such that you'd be able to come back and land on the exact right place is extremely unlikely.
The whole how unbelievable it is for him to land squarely down on the touchdown pad. Maybe the episode could have then, you know, transferred to a different location. Because if they did, it would then nullify about Regan breaking into the Space Center again.
Oh, yes.
You already had your end.
Because if it was a different location, you would have to then, you know, break into a new. I guess, but obviously we don't have the budget for multiple locations, so...
They've already spaffed all the budget up the wall.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, so we had earlier something that we can say with general certainty was inspired somewhat by Space Odyssey. The going to the light thing, the fleshiness, the slowness of it. What we have here is a very visual kind of understanding of Space Odyssey. The Doctor would have taken hours and hours and hours in order to get back to Earth from space. When you read the book, it's like, we're going to the moon and we'll be there in 2 days. What we have here is a visual taking, but not a methodical taking. It's not furthering the science or the realism. It's just taking what's cool about it. And it's showing the sort of limited impact some things can have. And you really have to take what's good for your story. And Doctor Who here is sort of making that general reference. But Space Odyssey obviously isn't going to impact everything. And I think that's an important point to make, because some people talk about Space Odyssey as though it was after this point there was giant change. But no, these stories still obviously existed. They just took what they needed with that visual language.
Space Odyssey is only revolutionary in terms of its effects on science fiction, in terms of how it looked. Not actually what it was about. The fact it was hard science didn't really make much headway, did it?
Carrington believes that the Doctor's now part of the alien conspiracy, to the bemusement of the Brig and Cornish. We learn that the Security Council are still debating what to do, thanks Hulk, whilst Carrington's mind is completely set on destroying the alien spaceship because he thinks it's his moral duty. Which leads to the best line reading from Cornish, "I think he's insane." The Doctor is brought to Liz and the ambassadors, and he's threatened to make a communication device to help the conspirators. With escape seemingly impossible, General Carrington then pays a visit and prepares to assassinate the Doctor. Gee, I wonder if he's part of the conspirators of death.
What you have in this episode is people taking advantage of stuff. So Carrington is trying to push his agenda through paranoia. Regan is kind of representative of ignorance and selfishness. And the aliens are sort of representing, I'm not really sure, I think they're sort of like the looming threat and time and patience running out and that
sort
of thing.
And when they're not, the naivete for coming to Earth in the first place and then being completely ousted by the greed or paranoia.
Mm. What this story is kind of framing it as is that the authorities know what's going on and are scared, and the commoners don't, and if they do, they don't really care. Which I think, if you were to look at this as a Cold War analogue, is an interesting way of framing it. You know, there are these people on the lower levels of society who are ignorant and are looking to make a quick buck. The people at the top have the real existential dread to deal with and are making the wrong decisions through fear.
Hmm. We can also extend that back to Nick's point about how public's interest rises and falls depending on the events going in the Apollo moon missions. So they actually get to the moon. Hooray. They're threatened with imminent destruction with Apollo 13. Hooray. Otherwise, it's just a normal space flight and people sleep.
People get bored of space, really.
Eventually. Ask not what you can do for your space program. Ask what the space program can do for you.
Around about this time, isn't it, that people start to realise space is really boring? It's not this fantastic land at all. I mean, I guess it's fantastic in a certain sense, but it's not in the way that people thought it was.
And then by the time you get to 1979 and the astronauts become a bit more sort of humanised, that goes even further through the floor. I want to talk a bit more about fear at the top and ignorance at the bottom. What do you guys think about that?
I think actually probably quite appropriate for the current times that we find ourselves in.
Those at the top are fearful, even though they have all the equipment at their disposal, either A, to deal with it, or B, not die from it. And those at the bottom are either equally fearful because they've been told to do so, or they are ignorant because they want to rebel against the people at the top, and both are dying.
Well, so in my current place of employ, I come into contact with many members of the public, and for a long time, once this started to become a big story, so let's say late January, from about late January till early March, I had lots and lots of people go, oh, it's just a flu, it's not that important. And even, let's see, what, in the about a week before the UK lockdown was announced.
Great UK lockdown of March 2022, insert end date here.
Yeah.
Just in case.
It took a long time for, I think, people down, you know, just regular people to realise just,
It's been a gradual build-up, even now, to the time of recording. It's continuing to build up and up and up, cataclysmically and horrifically, I might add.
Yes. Mm. The thing that really... I was worried about it, but not that worried about it for a long time. What really changed my mind was that, I believe this changed the government of the United Kingdom's mind as well, was on the 16th of March, there was a University College London report about how bad it would be if, let's say, nothing was done to contain the crisis.
Yeah, and equally measured was how the current government level of response led to a certain amount of deaths.
Yes, it was quite a lot.
Yeah.
Yes, comparable to the Second World War, potentially.
Pretty much.
Yeah, and there's this same idea that the people at the top aren't telling you everything that they know. And there's also this idea, I've seen so many news reports of people stockpiling, not just because they want the stuff, but because they don't want others to have it. You know, there's a selfishness going on as well by people of all classes, of course, but I think this kind of more petty selfishness is kind of what Regan's exemplifying here.
You could also argue that General Carrington is both the example of fearful through paranoia and ignorance, because ultimately, yes, he, spoilers, did encounter the aliens on his previous Mars probe, but he doesn't know that they are benign, i.e. ignorant, and doesn't want to know that they are benign. He has been set in his ways, and so you could argue that the top nowadays are both fearful and ignorant.
Yeah, that's true.
They are dealing with a totally unknown alien disease.
The spectrum of how people can turn into in a crisis, from good and bad, you know. So as you say, you've got Regan. He's selfish and only thinking about himself and wants to make a quick buck. How can he make profit from this crisis? You've got Carrington. It's turned him into a crazed, scared man with this threat. But then you've got like Cornish. He's always calm, collected. He's responding really well to this crisis. Obviously, then you've got the Brigadier. You know, he's willing to use violence, but in a good way. He's proportional about it, only if it must be done. He doesn't want to shoot down the aliens. He actually wants to see what they are first before taking any action. So you're seeing how different people react in a crisis, which we're seeing now as well in the world.
Only through this episode of Doctor Who 50 years ago can we look at character traits in the leading characters as written by a man of certain political persuasion, and hereby thence compare and contrast it to the character traits of the world and various leaders and the population nowadays in a certain crisis, which isn't going to go away anytime soon, which is why we're talking about it. There you are. That sets the podcast between 50 years ago and now. Thank you very much for watching. You can find us on Blogspot, which redirects to iTunes. Leave positive comments there. It helps. You can also find us on Facebook and YouTube, where you can like, comment and subscribe nicely. We shall be back next week with the final episode of The Ambassadors of Death, because it's our moral duty to do so. Until then, I've been Ben.
I've been Luke.
And I've been Nick.
Thank you, and goodbye.